Thank you. Good morning, everybody. I'll talk quickly on what we've been doing in digital integration as a service. Just a quick introduction. Look at the key drivers for the solution. Why do we build this? The overview of the solution itself. High-level platform architecture. We'll also have a look at demo screens just to see a sample of how the solution looks like. And then a value prop to close the session. About Wipro, for those who are not familiar, based in India, global IT services organization. There are some figures out there that you can see, about 1,000 odd customers, quite a few number of employees across the world. Myself, in case you didn't hear me introduce, this is what I do. I've been in this industry for quite some time, primarily on integration. I've also looked at JMS and quite some time, some Corba was being spoken about yesterday. I've also looked at Ionics, etc. So, with that out of the way, let's look at the key drivers for the solution. Why did we actually go ahead and build this solution? We've been working with various customers, as you can see from Wipro's profile. From the integration side, what were some of the key asks that we were getting over and over again? So many of these customers have different integration products. Of course, WSO2 figures. There's also other competing products in the APIM space, in the ESB space, for B2B that customers use. There's no one single integration product. And if you look at global customers who are like the Fortune 50s or Fortune 100s, there are large business units within the customer organization itself which use different products. So business unit A may use, let's say, for example, Apache Camel. There could be another unit which uses WSO2 ESB. There could be a third one which is doing some custom integration. So there is a whole set of integration products that are getting used. There's no real visibility in terms of how many integrations are there within the enterprise. If they have chosen to do a governance registry implementation also, that would give a perspective on one of the units, unless it is done at an org level, at the enterprise level. So that is one of the things that we have seen or heard our customers keep saying. We don't know how many integrations are there. Is there an integration that takes customer data from, say, SAP to Salesforce or SAP to Siebel? So that leads to the next point where governance is difficult. So there is a new interface that gets built. Somebody asks for it. They don't have a place to go and check whether that it exists or not. Just go on building, and then it becomes duplicates, proliferation of point-to-point spaghetti, and all those kind of mess starts coming in. So that is where governance is kind of required to ensure that there is some level of check before another one gets into the getting deployed or becoming productionized. A couple of other points to close the drivers. One is in terms of the domain APIs. So a lot of customers are looking to jumpstart the work that they are doing in their respective domains. So for example, open banking. Yesterday there was a panel discussion where folks spoke about your adoption of open banking. So that is also something that we are hearing a lot. Our customers are asking for open banking APIs to be implemented, to be hosted at one place that could help them speed up their development efforts. And there are also other domains like telecom, for instance, which is looking at TM Forum as a standard to actually use the API definitions, put in some implementation on that, kickstart that, or help them speed up their development process or efforts. Finally, in terms of commonly occurring integration errors, so you have some errors like log files going full or queues running out of space or, getting full and then I can't put in more messages on that. So typically what happens, you send an alert and then there is a support personnel who has the access and they go in and then they purge the log files or they actually clear up the queues by moving it to a dead letter queue or something. But there are certain things that could be automated so that this effort that we do from a manual basis can be reduced. So these are some of the things that we were going on hearing from our customers repeatedly. So I thought we could combine all this and come up with a solution that would help many of our customers. Digital integration as a service, DIAS for short. I also noticed that DIAS is a fairly common surname here in Sri Lanka. We used to be big fans of Roy DIAS when he was a player. So anyway, so that's why we chose that name. An extra A, I know that, but yeah, anyway. So what does DIAS do? So it's a hybrid integration solution, provides a unified view of integrations across APIs, across microservices, B2B components. So how does it do that? Through a self-service portal. You'll also get to see the screens of screenshots of that. There's a domain API marketplace, which kind of addresses the other point that customers are looking for in terms of functional banking or TM forum, telecom, et cetera. Then the capability to automatically fix commonly occurring integration errors. Finally, from a B2B point of view, we have an accelerator where it helps onboard trading partners faster. So for those who are not very familiar with B2B integration, so data typically gets exchanged in EDI or XML standards, and there's a kind of setup that's required before that happens. So you'll have to establish communication channels in terms of see the connectivity if it is working well. You have certificates that need to be deployed. You need to look for transformation rules. So purchase order, how does it look like on one side and how does it look like for the other customer? What are the rules that are there from a data transformation point of view? There's a whole bunch of things that goes into trading partner integration. So what does this accelerator do? So this accelerator helps reduce a bit of effort when you do that. So it actually reduces effort through some templates that we have, through some testing accelerators that we have, so that there is a bit of time saved in terms of testing, in terms of setting up those rules between those trading partners. Yeah. So this is how the high-level platform architecture looks like. So you have multiple channels that come in. They can talk to the solution, which has the core building blocks as the API management part from WSO2. The Wipro MF Task solution, this is an in-house solution that is built in terms of exchanging or doing B2B integration, managed file transfer solution. MF Task stands for Managed File Transfer as a Service. And then you have the self-service portal, which is the key core component of the entire solution that talks to all of these components. You have the Wipro Elixir solution, which is the self-healing part, which actually fixes the commonly occurring integration errors. Then you have the domain APIs, which are deployed on top of WSO2 APIM. And we have a bunch of microservices that can be hosted in whatever platforms you choose like. We are unopinionated about that. The management of that, we're using Eureka to manage those microservices. So from the self-service portal, you could actually look at the health of the microservices, whether they are up and running, if there is something that needs to be fixed. So it's a single place to look at the health of the microservices. The APIs also, you can also talk to the B2B components through MF Task. So that self-service portal will give you a holistic view of the integrations that are there in a particular enterprise. So that is from a high-level point of view. If we go into the details, we have used APIs from WSO2 to get the details about the APIs that are deployed. And to be honest, we have actually had made use of a lot of documentation, very descriptive, so you exactly know what parameters you give and what you get. So that has kind of helped us. So speaking from a person who has looked at other products where the documentation is sparse or sometimes you have to dig in deep, and this being open source, we have the ability to also open up the source and go to a particular file to see how exactly a particular parameter has been implemented in code. So all that gives us the benefit of using WSO2 very closely with the solution. So we know exactly what parameters need to go in, what we get as the response, and then we can put it in our UI and show it to the customers as one single solution. These are some of the APIs that we have used. Publisher APIs, WSO2 API publisher APIs. We have used the retrieve search APIs to get the list of APIs that are deployed. We have used get details of an API. So for a particular API, what is the swagger spec that is associated with it? What is the description, if you like? All those things come through the get details of an API. So, and then get API content also, if there are some documents associated with that. So we have used that as well. To round it off, we have also used the analytics APIs, which is like get faults by API, get API usage. You get to see the screen where we have made use of these. With that, let's look at the demo screens. So this is the home page of the solution itself. So starting from left top, so you have the transaction dashboard, which actually talks about what are the status, or how do you look at the status or the transaction of the or the requests that go into an API and when the response comes out. Then you have the API Explorer, which lists the domain APIs. You have the developer's workbench, which is basically a shortcut to WSO2APIM itself, where you can go ahead and define or create your APIs. Analytics, which pulls in the analytics from APIM for various API parameters, such as faults or API resource usage and things like that. B2B calls out the Wipro MF task solution to do the trading partner integration. Requests and approvals. Requests and approvals is from the governance point of view. So here we are actually looking at access for any APIs from a consuming point of view. So if the API has enough resources to support more consumers, the access to consume that API will be approved. So for example, I have a customer API that provides details about customers. It fetches details from, let's say, Salesforce. And then there is an application in the organization that wants to make use of that API. So they are requesting access. A person with approval authority could get in and then approve or reject that request based on the capability of the API where it is deployed. If it can take up more consumers, yes, that request will be approved, and then the person who requested can start consuming that API. Finally, we have the configuration settings for the solution itself inside the management console. So this is the transaction dashboard. So here, if you see, it's fairly small, so I'll try to read out. So we have a lot of APIs listed here along with timestamps. All this data is pulled out of WSO2APIM. So it shows when a particular request went in. So at the bottom, I'll call out for people who can't see that, it's pretty small font. So there is a products API, and then there is a time which it says the request went in, and then when the response came out. So in and out. Why is this helpful? Many times, you want to figure out, or when you deploy a particular API, you want to see whether it is functioning well. Is there a latency? Does it need more resources? Is it adequate wherever it is deployed? Can it give us a response in a decent amount of time? Or if there is some issue that needs to be fixed. So all those kind of things can be analyzed based on some of these tracking parameters. You also can see if it has errored out. So you didn't get a response. You called a products API, and you just want to know what happened. There's no response. Go in there, see all those red stuff in there shows the errors that have happened. So you never got a response. So you go there, and you know why. OK, this is an interesting feature that we have had here. So it is, so apart from tracking, so what is next? So we want to actually go one step further and automate some of the commonly occurring, automate the fixing of commonly occurring errors. So we call those fixes as heals. So if I describe this dashboard, so it has three components essentially. So one on the left is called the actionable heals, which is essentially the heals which are of two types. So you can automatically fix certain errors like log file going full, go ahead and purge that log file in a location. So that can be done automatically. But if let's say if it's a data-related error, there is a transformation rule that failed, do you want to automatically fix that, or do you want a user to go in and look at what exactly happened and then apply that fix? So you can choose to execute that script that fixes that transformation error, or you can choose to ignore that. So those are actionable heels. So these 9 heels that you're seeing require human intervention to go in and see and then execute that fix or ignore it. Those are the 9 ones. One in the middle shows the fixes per server. So it comes under one roof. Governance, it helps governance because everything is at one place. You can either allow, disallow, access, encourage, reuse, etc. And then in terms of having domain APIs helps in reducing the time to market. And then there is a substantial effort saved through the automation by doing the commonly, I'm sorry, by doing the automation of the commonly occurring errors.